This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The Pirates of Panama by A. O. Alexandre Olivier, Exquemelin. Chapter 1. The introduction. The author sets forth for the Western Islands in the service of the West India Company of France. They meet with an English frigate and arrive at the island of Tortuga. We set sail from Havre de Grace in France, from whence we set sail in the ship called St. John, May 2, 1666. Our vessel was equipped with 28 guns, 20 mariners, and 220 passengers, including those whom the company sent as free passengers. Soon after, we came to an anchor under the Cape of Barfleur, there to join 7 other ships of the same West India Company, which were to come from Dieppe, under convoy of a man of war, mounted with 37 guns and 250 men. Of these ships, 2 were bound for Senegal, 5 for the Caribbean islands, and ours for Tortuga. Here gathered to us about 20 sail of other ships, bound for Newfoundland, with some Dutch vessels going for Nantes, Rochelle, and St. Martin's, so that in all we made 30 sail. Here we put ourselves in a posture of defense, having noticed that 4 English frigates, of 60 guns each, waited for us near Alderney. Our admiral, the Chevalier Sourdis, having given necessary orders, we sailed thence with a favorable gale, and some mists arising totally impeded the English frigates from discovering our fleet. We steered our course as near as we could to the coast of France, for fear of the enemy. As we sailed along, we met a vessel of Ostend, who complained to our admiral that a French privateer had robbed him that very morning, whereupon we endeavored to pursue the said pirate, but our labor was in vain, not being able to overtake him. Our fleet, as we sailed, caused no small fears and alarms to the inhabitants of the coasts of France, these judging us to be English, and that we sought some convenient place for landing. To allay their fright, we hung out our colors, but they would not trust us. After this, we came to an anchor in the Bay of Conquet in Brittany, near Ushant, there to take in water. Having stored ourselves with fresh provisions here, we prosecuted our voyage, designing to pass by the Ross of Fontenau, and not expose ourselves to the Sorlingas, fearing the English that were cruising thereabouts. The river Ross is of a current very strong and rapid, which, rolling over many rocks, disgorges itself into the sea, on the coast of France, in 48 deg, 10 minimum latitude, so that this passage is very dangerous, all the rocks as yet being not thoroughly known. Here I shall mention the ceremony, which at this passage, and some other places, is used by the mariners, and by them called baptism, though it may seem little to our purpose. The master's mate clothed himself with a ridiculous sort of garment that reached to his feet, and on his head he put a suitable cap, made very burlesque. In his right hand he had a naked wooden sword, and in his left a pot full of ink. His face was horribly blacked with soot, and his neck adorned with a collar of many little pieces of wood. Thus apparelled, he commanded every one to be called who had never passed through that dangerous place before, and then, causing them to kneel down, he made the sign of the cross on their foreheads with ink, and gave every one a stroke on the shoulders with his wooden sword. Meanwhile, the standers by cast a bucket of water upon each man's head, and so ended the ceremony. But that done, each of the baptized must give a bottle of brandy, placing it nigh the main mast without speaking a word, even those who have no such liquor not being excused. If the vessel never passed that way before, the captain is obliged to distribute some wine among the mariners and passengers. But as for other gifts, which the newly baptized frequently offer, they are divided among the old seamen, and of them they make a banquet among themselves. The Hollanders likewise, not only at this passage, but also at the rocks called Berlingas, nigh the coast of Portugal, in 39 deg 40 minimum, being a passage very dangerous, especially by night, When in the dark the rocks are not distinguishable, the land being very high, they use some such ceremony. But their manner of baptizing is very different from that of the French, for he that is to be baptized is fastened and hoisted up thrice at the mainyard's end, as if he were a criminal. If he be hoisted the fourth time, in the name of the Prince of Orange, or of the captain of the vessel, his honor is more than ordinary. Thus every one is dipped several times in the main ocean, but he that is dipped first has the honor of being saluted with a gun. Such as are not willing to fall must pay 12 pence for ransom, if he be an officer, 2 shillings, and if a passenger, at their own pleasure. If the ship never passed that way before, the captain is to give a small rundlet of wine, which, if he denies, the mariners may cut off the stem of the vessel. All the profit accruing by this ceremony is kept by the master's mate, who, after reaching their port, usually lays it out in wine, which is drank amongst the ancient seamen. Some say this ceremony was instituted by the Emperor Charles V, though it is not amongst his laws. But here I leave these sea customs, and return to our voyage. Having passed the Ross, we had very good weather, till we came to Cape Finisterre. Here a sudden tempest surprised us, and separated our ship from the rest that were in our company. This storm continued 8 days, in which time it would move compassion to see how miserably the passengers were tumbled to and fro on all sides of the ship, insomuch that the mariners, in the performance of their duty, were compelled to tread upon them. This boisterous weather being over, we had very favorable gales again, till we came to the Tropic of Cancer. This tropic is an imaginary circle, which astronomers have invented in the heavens, limiting the progress of the sun towards the North Pole. It is placed in the latitude of 23 deg, 30 minutes. Here we were baptized a second time, as before. The French always perform this ceremony at the Tropic of Cancer, as also under the Tropic of Capricorn. In this part of the world we had very favorable weather, at which we were very glad, because of our great want of water. For that element is so scarce with us, that we were stinted to 2 half pints a man every day. About the latitude of Barbados, we met an English frigate, or privateer, who first began to give us chase, but finding herself not to exceed us in force, presently got away. Hereupon we pursued her, firing several guns, 8-pounders at her, but at length she escaped, and we returned to our course. Soon after, we came within sight of Martinico. We were bent to the coast of the Isle of St. Peter, but were frustrated by a storm, which took us hereabouts. Hence we resolved to steer to Guadeloupe, yet we could not reach this island, by reason of the said storm, so that we directed our course to the Isle of Tortuga, being the very same land we were bound to. We passed along the coast of Punta Rica, which is extremely agreeable and delightful to the sight, being adorned with beautiful woods, even to the tops of the mountains. Then we discovered Hispaniola, of which I shall give a description, and we coasted about it till we came to Tortuga, our desired port. Here we anchored, July 7th, in the same year, not having lost one man in the voyage. We landed the goods that belonged to the West India Company, and soon after, the ship was sent to Cal-de-Sac with some passengers. End of the chapter. Chapter 2. A description of Tortuga, the fruits and plants there, how the French first settled there at 2 several times and forced out the Spaniards, the author twice sold in the said island. The island of Tortuga is situate on the north side of Hispaniola, in 20 deg, 30 minimum latitude, its just extent is 80 leagues about. The Spaniards who gave name to this island, called it so from the shape of the land, in some manner resembling a great sea tortoise, called by them Tortuga de Mar. The country is very mountainous and full of rocks, and yet thick of lofty trees, that grow upon the hardest of those rocks, without partaking of a softer soil. Hence it comes that their roots, for the greatest part, are seen naked, entangled among the rocks like the branching of ivy against our walls. That part of this island which stretches to the north is totally uninhabited. The reason is, first, because it is incommodious and unhealthy, and secondly, for the ruggedness of the coast that gives no access to the shore, unless among rocks almost inaccessible. For this cause it is peopled only on the south part, which hath only one port indifferently good, yet this harbor has two entries or channels which afford passage to ships of 70 guns, the port itself being without danger, and capable of receiving a great number of vessels. The inhabited parts, of which the first is called the lowlands or low country, this is the chief among the rest, because it contains the port aforesaid. The town is called Caona, and here live the chiefest and richest planters of the island. The second part is called the middle plantation. Its soil is yet almost new, being only known to be good for tobacco. The third is named Ringo, and is situate towards the west part of the island. The fourth and last is called the mountain, in which place were made the first plantations upon this island. As to the wood that grows here, we have already said that the trees are exceeding tall, and pleasing to the sight, whence no man will doubt, but they may be applied to several uses. Such is the yellow saunder, which by the inhabitants is called bois de chandelle, or in English candlewood, because it burns like a candle and serves them with light while they fish by night. Here grows also lignum sanctum, or guaiacum. Its virtues are very well known, more especially to those who observe not the seventh commandment, and are given to impure copulations, physicians drawing hence in several compositions the greatest antidote for venereal diseases, as also for cold and viscous humors. The trees likewise, which afford gummy elemi, grow here in great abundance, as doth radix chenae or China root, yet this is not so good as that of other parts of the Western world. It is very white and soft, and serves for pleasant food to the wild boars when they can find nothing else. This island also is not deficient in aloes, nor an infinite number of the other medicinal herbs, which may please the curiosity of such as are given to their contemplation. Moreover, for building of ships, or any other sort of architecture, here are found several sorts of timber. The fruits likewise, which grow here abundantly, are nothing inferior in quantity or quality to what other islands produce. I shall name only some of the most ordinary and common. Such are magnoit, potatoes, abaju apples, yanas, bicones, piques, carousels, mamanes, anananes, and divers other sorts which I omit to specify. Here grow likewise in great numbers those trees called palmitos or palmites, whence is drawn a certain juice which serves the inhabitants instead of wine, and whose leaves cover their houses instead of tiles. In this island aboundeth also the wild boar. The governor hath prohibited the hunting of them with dogs, fearing lest, the island being but small, the whole race of them in a short time should be destroyed. The reason why he thought convenient to preserve these wild beasts was, that in case of any invasion, the inhabitants might sustain themselves with their food, especially were they once constrained to retire to the woods and mountains. Yet this sort of game is almost impeded by itself, by reason of the many rocks and precipices, which, for the greatest part, are covered with little shrubs, very green and thick, whence the huntsmen have oftentimes fallen, and left us the sad remembrance of many a memorable disaster. At a certain time of the year, there resort to Tortuga large flocks of wild pigeons, and then the inhabitants feed on them very plentifully, having more than they can consume, and leaving totally to their repose all other sorts of fowl, both wild and tame, that so, in the absence of the pigeons, these may supply their place. But as nothing in the universe, though never so pleasant, can be found, but what hath something of bitterness with it, the very symbol of this truth we see in the aforesaid pigeons. For these, the season being past, can scarce be touched with the tongue, they become so extremely lean and bitter even to admiration. The reason of this bitterness is attributed to a certain seed which they eat about that time, even as bitter as gall. About the seashores everywhere are found great multitudes of crabs, both of land and sea, and both sorts very big. These are good to feed servants and slaves, whose palates they please, but are very hurtful to the sight. Besides, being eaten too often, they cause great giddiness in the head, with much weakness of the brain, so that very frequently they are deprived of sight for a quarter of an hour. The French, having settled in the Isle of St. Christopher, planted there a sort of trees, of which, at present, there possibly may be greater quantities, with the timber whereof they made long boats and hoys, which they sent thence westward, well manned and victualled, to discover other islands. These, setting sail from St. Christopher, came within sight of Hispaniola, where they arrived with abundance of joy. Having landed, they marched into the country, where they found large quantities of cattle, such as cows, bulls, horses, and wild boars, but finding no great profit in these animals unless they could enclose them, and knowing likewise the island to be pretty well peopled by the Spaniards, they thought it convenient to enter upon and seize the island of Tortuga. This they performed without any difficulty, there being upon the island no more than 10 or 12 Spaniards to guard it. These few men let the French come in peaceably, and possessed the island for 6 months without any trouble. Meanwhile they passed and repassed with their canoes to Hispaniola, from whence they transported many people, and at last began to plant the whole island of Tortuga. The few Spaniards remaining there, perceiving the French to increase their number daily, began at last to repine at their prosperity and grudge them the possession. Hence they gave notice to others of their nation, their neighbors, who sent several boats, well armed and manned, to dispossess the French. This expedition succeeded according to their desires, for the new possessors, seeing the great number of Spaniards, fled with all they had to the woods, and hence by night they wafted over with canoes to the island of Hispaniola. This they the more easily performed, having no women or children with them, nor any great substance to carry away. Here they also retired into the woods, both to seek for food, and from thence, with secrecy, to give intelligence to others of their own faction, judging for certain that within a little while they should be in a capacity to hinder the Spaniards from fortifying in Tortuga. Meanwhile the Spaniards of the great island ceased not to seek after their new guests, the French, with intent to root them out of the woods if possible, or cause them to perish with hunger. But this design soon failed, having found that the French were masters both of good guns, powder, and bullets. Here therefore the fugitives waited for a certain opportunity, wherein they knew the Spaniards were to come from Tortuga with arms, and a great number of men, to join with those of the greater island for their destruction. When this occasion offered, they in the meanwhile, deserting the woods where they were, returned to Tortuga, and dispossessed the small number of Spaniards that remained at home. Having so done, they fortified themselves the best they could, thereby to prevent the return of the Spaniards, in case they should attempt it. Moreover, they sent immediately to the governor of St. Christopher's, craving his aid and relief, and demanding of him a governor, the better to be united among themselves, and strengthened on all occasions. The governor of St. Christopher's received their petition with much satisfaction, and without delay sent Monsieur Le Pousseur to them in quality of a governor, together with a ship full of men, and all necessaries for their establishment and defense. No sooner had they received this recruit, but the governor commanded a fortress to be built upon the top of a high rock, from whence he could hinder the entrance of any ships or other vessels to the port. To this fort, no other access could be had than by almost climbing through a very narrow passage that was capable only of receiving 2 persons at once, and those not without difficulty. In the middle of this rock was a great cavity, which now serves for a storehouse. Besides, here was great convenience for raising a battery. The fort being finished, the governor commanded 2 guns to be mounted, which could not be done without great toil and labor, as also a house to be built within the fort, and afterwards the narrow way that led to the said fort, to be broken and demolished, leaving no other ascent thereto than by a ladder. Within the fort gushes out a plentiful fountain of pure fresh water, sufficient to refresh a garrison of 1,000 men. Being possessed of these conveniences, and the security these things might promise, the French began to people the island, and each of them to seek their living, some by hunting, others by planting tobacco, and others by cruising and robbing upon the coasts of the Spanish islands, which trade is continued by them to this day. The Spaniards notwithstanding could not behold, but with jealous eyes, the daily increase of the French in Tortuga, fearing lest in time they might by them be dispossessed also of Hispaniola. Thus taking an opportunity, when many of the French were abroad at sea, and others employed in hunting, with 800 men in several canoes, they landed again in Tortuga, almost without being perceived by the French, but finding that the governor had cut down many trees for the better discovery of any enemy in case of an assault, as also that nothing of consequence could be done without great guns, they consulted about the fittest place for raising a battery. This place was soon concluded to be the top of a mountain which was in sight, seeing that from thence alone they could level their guns at the fort, which now lay open to them since the cutting down of the trees by the new possessors. Hence they resolved to open a way for the carriage of some pieces of ordnance to the top. This mountain is somewhat high, and the upper part thereof plain, from whence the whole island may be viewed. The sides thereof are very rugged, by reason a great number of inaccessible rocks do surround it, so that the ascent was very difficult, and would always have been the same, had not the Spaniards undergone the immense labor and toil of making the way before mentioned, as I shall now relate. The Spaniards had with them many slaves and Indians, laboring men, whom they call matadas, or in English, half-yellow men. These they ordered with iron tools to dig a way through the rocks. This they performed with the greatest speed imaginable, and through this way, by the help of many ropes and pulleys, they at last made shift to get up two pieces of ordnance, wherewith they made a battery next day to play on the fort. Meanwhile, the French, knowing these designs, prepared for a defense, while the Spaniards were busy about the battery, sending notice everywhere to their companions for help. Thus the hunters of the island all joined together, and with them all the pirates, who were not already too far from home. These landed by night at Tortuga, lest they should be seen by the Spaniards, and under the same obscurity of the night, they all together, by a back way, climbed the mountain where the Spaniards were posted, which they did the more easily being acquainted with these rocks. They came up at the very instant that the Spaniards, who were above, were preparing to shoot at the fort, not knowing in the least of their coming. Here they set upon them at their backs with such fury as forced the greatest part to precipitate themselves from the top to the bottom, and dash their bodies in pieces. Few or none escaped, for if any remained alive, they were put to the sword. Some Spaniards did still keep the bottom of the mountain, but these, hearing the shrieks and cries of them that were killed, and believing some tragical revolution to be above, fled immediately towards the sea, despairing ever to regain the island of Tortuga. The governors of this island behaved themselves as proprietors and absolute lords thereof till 1664, when the West India Company of France took possession thereof and sent thither for their governor, Monsieur Ogeron. These planted the colony for themselves by their factors and servants, thinking to drive some considerable trade from thence with the Spaniards, even as the Hollanders do from Curaçao. But this design did not answer, for with other nations they could drive no trade, by reason they could not establish any secure commerce from the beginning with their own. Forasmuch as at the first institution of this company in France, they agreed with the pirates, hunters, and planters, first possessors of Tortuga, that these should buy all their necessaries from the said company upon trust. And though this agreement was put in execution, yet the factors of the company soon after found that they could not recover either monies or returns from those people. that they were constrained to bring some armed men into the island in behalf of the company to get in some of their payments. But neither this endeavor, nor any other, could prevail towards the settling a second trade with those of the island. Hereupon, the company recalled their factors, giving them orders to sell all that was their own in the said plantation, both the servants belonging to the company, which were sold, some for 20, and others for 30 pieces of 8, as also all other merchandises and proprieties. And thus all their designs fell to the ground. On this occasion I was also sold, being a servant under the said company in whose service I left France, but my fortune was very bad, for I fell into the hands of the most cruel and perfidious man that ever was born, who was then governor, or rather lieutenant general, of that island. This man treated me with all the hard usage imaginable, yea, with that of hunger, with which I thought I should have perished inevitably. Withal, he was willing to let me buy my freedom and liberty, but not under the rate of 300 pieces of 8, I not being master of one at a time in the world. At last, through the manifold miseries I endured, as also affliction of mind, I was thrown into a dangerous sickness. This misfortune, added to the rest, was the cause of my happiness, for my wicked master, seeing my condition, began to fear lest he should lose his monies with my life. Hereupon he sold me a second time to a surgeon, for 70 pieces of 8. Being with this second master, I began soon to recover my health through the good usage I received, he being much more humane and civil than my first patron. He gave me both clothes and very good food, and after I had served him but 1 year, he offered me my liberty with only this condition, that I should pay him 100 pieces of 8 when I was in a capacity so to do, which kind proposal of his I could not but accept with infinite joy and gratitude. Being now at liberty, though like Adam when he was first created, that is, naked and destitute of all human necessaries, not knowing how to get my living, I determined to enter into the order of the pirates or robbers at sea. Into this society I was received with common consent, both of the superior and vulgar sort, where I continued till 1672. Having assisted them in all their designs and attempts, and served them in many notable exploits, of which hereafter I shall give the reader a true account, I return to my own native country. But before I begin my relation, I shall say something of the island Hispaniola, which lies towards the western part of America, as also give my reader a brief description thereof, according to my slender ability and experience. End of the chapter. Chapter 3. A Description of Hispaniola, also a relation of the French buccaneers. The large and rich island called Hispaniola is situate from 17 degrees to 19 degrees latitude. The circumference is 300 leagues, the extent from east to west 120, its breadth almost 50, being broader or narrower at certain places. This island was first discovered by Christopher Columbus, A.D. 1492, he being sent for this purpose by Ferdinand, King of Spain, from which time to this present the Spaniards have been continually possessors thereof. There are upon this island very good and strong cities, towns and hamlets, as well as a great number of pleasant country houses and plantations, the effects of the care and industry of the Spaniards its inhabitants. The chief city and metropolis hereof is Santo Domingo, being dedicated to Saint Dominic, from whom it derives its name. It is situate towards the south, and affords a most excellent prospect, the country round about being embellished with innumerable rich plantations, as also verdant meadows and fruitful gardens, all which produce plenty and variety of excellent pleasant fruits, according to the nature of those countries. The governor of the island resides in this city, which is, as it were, the storehouse of all the cities, towns, and villages, which hence export and provide themselves with all necessaries for human life, and yet hath it this particularity above many other cities, that it entertains no commerce with any nation but its own, the Spaniards. The greatest part of the inhabitants are rich and substantial merchants or shopkeepers. Another city of this island is San Jago, or St. James, being consecrated to that apostle. This is an open place.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.